My name's Steph. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I'm involved in the objective for CIs and CD in Fedora, which is, which really has potential to change a whole bunch of how we work and remove a lot of the maintenance burden and help us move quicker and get past that flat part that that Matt showed in his, you know, dinosaur graphs. There's more of a talk on that tomorrow at 5. Yeah, in the grand 2, I think. I wish these talks were the other way around. So we're gonna go. Imagine you've come back in time, and now you're diving deep. You're diving deep into the tests. In the future, no. In the past, no. In that other talk, you're going to. I want to share more of the vision why tests are so fundamental and important and what they enable. But now we've transported ourselves here to look at the tests themselves. And in addition, we'll have an introduction to the tests in Fedora, the goals, how they're laid out, how they work. And then there's a workshop by Fred that goes into actually doing these things. We can get started on doing these things if I run out of words to say during this talk that we can get started on that, but we actually want to hack on real tests and curate tests and work on bringing tests into Fedora. But Fred, what time is that?
It's too long.
Well, tomorrow and Thursday, we can actually look and see. It would 10 a.m. Cool. All right, so what is the goal of what we're doing here? The goal and end result is that we curate tests the way we curate source code in a distro. For a long time, we take this for granted now, but it really was an awesome thing that a distro took source code from all of the internet, brought it together in a standard way. Some people have weird tarballs, some people distribute some shell script that dumps code on your system, and some people have pure Git repos and so on. We bring it all into Diskit in a standard way, and we're able to then build something off of it. We're able to do weird and different things from it, obviously use it for different, for systems, for containers, and so on. We're gonna do the same thing with tests. Very much ties in with open source, bringing together the efforts of the open source community and curating it. Tests, in this context, when we talk about them, we're not talking about unit tests. We're talking about tests that validate a complete system. Now, I know sometimes that might raise questions in your mind. What is a complete system? What is a complete Fedora system? It's a system that is set up as a user, or a customer, or a cloud would use that system, would use it in production. So rather than being a build root where you test stuff or a single package where you test stuff, it is a complete system. So a good example is, a weird way to think of this is that it's not a, you don't get to put your hand inside your software like a sock puppet and make it do things. You have to interact with it from the outside. You have to interact with it from the tools and commands and so on. And that means let's take an example of curl. Let's say you wanted to test curl. You don't get to go inside the internals of curl and figure out is it making its HTTP request right and so on. What you do get to set up is a full system, how it uses OpenSSL, how it uses certificates, how it maybe uses its various dependencies such as libssh, and then set up a little server for it to interact with and check that it make sure that it works. You can also break things in that setup, as you would find in real life in production, and of course make sure that the tests fail.
So, I have a question. Uh-huh. So I know that curl has pretty extensive test suite. So what's the point of creating a new test suite if there is already one present?
That's a good question. We're going to come back to that, but let's make sure that we understand that slide earlier. We're curating tests. Sometimes we invent them ourselves. Same way, sometimes we invent source code in Fedora ourselves. Pretty often. But most of the time, we curate source code from elsewhere and build it in a certain way and make it predictable how that is then run through the process and get gotten out to users. And the same with the test. So if curl has an extensive test suite, which it does, then we would curate it and invoke it in a standard way. Really important is to make the tests as easy to update as the package itself. It's not okay to have the tests be a mysterious thing that hide off somewhere else. They need to be able to be updated as easily as the software that we have been working with in Fedora this whole time. Oops, there we have a duplicate. We want to find and fix bugs while the code is fresh in our minds, rather than months or years later. If someone tests a change that you've brought into Fedora as a package maintainer and tests it much later, months, or maybe it goes downstream, years later, find out that there's a bug there, as the maintainer, or even as a developer of that code, you're going to forget why you made that change. And it's going to be really hard to kind of remember, oh my god, what happened? Why did I do this? Whereas if it happens immediately, right away, and the tests are right there, together with the code, we can run them and get feedback immediately. And then it's really fast to fix stuff. You have an idea of what's going on. You may have just seen the release notes from curl. You know why you're bringing in that new version, or why you applied a patch. And you can tell, oh, it used to work, now it doesn't. So how do we pull these kind of goals off? And here's where we go into the details.
Deets.
So this is something that's been happening for a while. And many of you have been involved in pushing this forward. And it's exactly the right decision. I'm glad we chose this as a Fedora project, to put the tests in this Git along with the source code. So along with the spec file, along sometimes the source code, along with the choice of which tarball and which version that you use, so that they can be updated together. And right now, this is in progress. Tests are going into this Git. There's one test in Diskit so far, but there's a whole bunch. I think there's another 80 that are ready to land in Diskit. And obviously, as we bring tests in Diskit, what happens?
Mm-hmm. Where are these tests coming?
That's a very good question. We have more about this later. I'll share a link to where you can go and look at this. But there's a lot of these tests that are...
Can you please repeat the question?
Oh, certainly. So the question is, where are these tests coming from? The one test that's in Diskit so far has come from an upstream project, similar to what Tomasz highlighted. Oh, an upstream project has a comprehensive test suite, and then we execute it in a standard way. That one is RPM OS Tree. Thanks, Jonathan, for making that happen. A whole bunch more tests are coming from the Red Hat QE folks, who have been writing tests, but we have not curated them in a standard way before. Now they're being curated in a standard way, brought here, ready to be brought into Diskit and invoked in the standard way, similar to how we package source code in the standard way. And I'll show you the link to that a little later. So we share, how do we make this happen, where we have different people in Diskit touching different parts of the Diskit repo? Well, it turns out that this is, initially it might be a bit of a change of thinking, but where we get to is that we share the responsibility for the tests and for the code. So oftentimes, if you find that if you're a package maintainer, bringing in a new package breaks the tests don't account for a new feature, either tests need an additional test or they're broken in some way, you get to actually change it at the same time. Just like we change the checksums of that new tarball, or we change, for example, sometimes a spec file needs to be updated, or old patches need to be thrown away, perhaps a new one brought in, maybe CVEs are merged upstream and so on. We do the same thing with the test. We start to care about the two together. Basically, here's the software itself, and here's the definition of how it should work. They're updated together with the source. And we started to think about, okay, in order to make this actually work, we need this curation of the tests to outlast the testing system that invokes them. RPM, whether you love it or hate it, well, you're in Fedora, so you better love it, has outlasted all sorts of stuff. In fact, it's even outlasted Yum. Now it's working with DNF. RPM works with OS Tree. It's outlasted and grown beyond tons of different kind of technologies that use it. And so that's what we needed to do with these tests, and what we've done is split the idea of the test away from the testing system that invokes it. Split the idea of the test and its framework and how it wants to do things. Some of them are really nice and cool, well written, understandable. Some of them are arcane and strange. It doesn't matter. The testing system, the CI pipeline, the any other automated testing system that invokes them, or even humans using the tests, it should be able to do it in a standard way and not have the two bound to each other forever after. You can have Jenkins invoke these tests. You can have Taskatron invoke these tests. You can have all sorts of different systems invoke these tests. And that is really important. So there's a spec. And it's at this link. We're going to open it in the web browser soon, so you don't have to be furiously typing the link. And this link, this spec is about how to discover tests, how to stage them, how to invoke them, and how to gather their results. Now we had on the Fedora CI mailing list, we had this posted. We had discussion about it. You can click going from this page. There's a lot of the options that were considered for this spec. I think there was three: an RPM package based, and shell script based spec where we talked about how to invoke them using a shell script, an Ansible-based spec for invoking the tests, and then also a auto package like Debian uses spec. And after the discussion, you can see all the logic, you can see everyone who weighed in and helped make this choice, and a lot of those people are here in this room. The Ansible one was the one that was chosen. So here's what a testing system is responsible to do. This is the part that uses the spec to invoke stuff. Sorry, the slides render rather poorly here. It's responsible to build a test subject. The test subject is the thing being tested. In some cases, that's a package. Build a package. I'd like to test this package. Now, it's a bit of a gray area. Like I said, we need to test that package in the context of a full system. But it turns out you can kind of tell Yum, hey, install all the dependencies for this, and you can hope to get close to what that package would, how it would behave on a complete system. But more specifically, some of the test subjects are really coherent, integrated subjects, such as a container image, a QCow image, an OS tree. Those are complete systems that then you'd say, I'd like to test this. I'd like to test this atomic host image. So that the testing system is responsible for building that. It's responsible for deciding which test suites, looking up which test suites in this Git, should we run against this thing? Scheduling jobs. Maybe it needs to start up some dummy nodes or some OpenStack nodes. And it stages the test suites. We'll look at the details of that. It invokes the tests in a standard way. It gathers the results that those things then put out, and it relays the results to something that's going to use them. That should be, if we don't relay the test results back into someone's workflow, some human's workflow in the process in Fedora, then the test sort of just, it's useless. To invoke them is useless. We're going to talk more about that on Thursday, but that's the responsibilities of the testing system. The standard interface is then the thing that the testing system uses. And this is the standard interface that uniquely identifies a test suite, stages a test suite and its dependencies, how to do that, provides the test subject to the test suite, tells us how to do that, tells us how to invoke the test suite in a consistent way and gather the results. So all the things that the testing system needs to do.
So, Steph, can I have a question? Mm-hmm. So the first bullet point was build the artifact. So why it won't get the artifact from Koji? Like, usually you want to build a thing in Koji and test it.
That's right.
To build it again.
Again, this is, okay, so we're going back in time here. So I will refer to my future self tomorrow. And when you do continuous integration, if you look up continuous integration on any definition, or old school continuous integration basically means bring the whole thing together, and just the act of bringing it together had these amazing results. And turns out there were humans. Remember, this is the 1800s now. But there are humans bringing this stuff together. When you brought automation into this, which is really important, you brought automation, machines, and so on into this, you needed a way for the machine to tell, I integrated this thing, now is it good or is it bad? Is it right or is it wrong? And that was the test. Therefore, continuous integration is so tightly now bound with tests because they are so fundamental to it. But even just the act of bringing it together had massive results. And that tells us that part of continuous integration is building the thing, is composing the thing, is preparing it in a way that a user would use it in production, and then running the tests on it. Now, it can call out to Koji to do that. Fair. It can call out to something else to do the compose, and so on. That's legit. But this is part of the entire CI process, part of what you would think of when you talk about continuous integration, is bringing it together. So lastly, this is something you have to remind yourself of a little. There's some surprises in here for people who have been involved with tests. The test suite, which is the thing that sits below that standard interface, is responsible to bring in any dependencies it needs, such as its test framework, such as the modularity test framework, or BeakerLib, or Python unit test, or whatever libraries it likes to use, and so on. It's responsible to execute that framework. It's responsible to provision any containers or images, VMs, or maybe a little cluster if the test needs it, and so on, itself. The test suite is responsible, very likely by its framework, so not every test has to reinvent this, is responsible to do that. Sometimes, although this is typically less reliable, it may call out to another cluster, or it may call out to do these things somewhere else. That's fair. Make sure that you know, okay, make sure that that's reliable. But that's all within the purview of the test suite and its framework. And it's responsible to provide the test results and test artifacts in the way that the standard describes. So, by the way, this is the framework for writing an Ansible module. It's called Ansibles. I kid you not. So if you want to go write an Ansible module, you're going to have to type the word Ansibles. Have fun.
Do you write a ball? Is that the unit? Or?
There is some string repping of your module going on to look for strings like this to know that it's an Ansible module. It is a ball. It's one of those balls made out of rubber bands. So, Ansible actually, it wasn't my first choice for this, but I think it's very good and it's the right choice that we've chosen here. And as we've built this out and gotten more experience with Ansible, some of the aspects of Ansible that we'll see actually really fit very well. The way that Ansible has dynamic inventory fits super well with the fact that this thing is supposed to launch its own containers and its own its own VMs and so on. That fit really well. The tagging of Ansible fit well. The way that Ansible allows us to then call out to any other shell-based test suite or bring in any of these things, it really is a good tool for this job. Keep in mind that if you don't like the way that Ansible represents its worldview, its playbooks and its tasks and so on, it's really easy. And we'll show you, we'll look at an example to have the test suite and test framework all be written in shell script or however you like. And literally this much Ansible to then just call it. And so Ansible is the standard that we use to invoke these things. We'll look at how we use Ansible. But if you're allergic to Ansible, then it's not a blocker. It's not a big problem. If you compare Ansible and RPM spec files on the, how many obscenities they generate from package maintainers trying to change them, probably RPM spec files will weigh down the scale quite a bit more. So it's not perfect, but it does work well. And whoops, for extra kicks, the rendering's not working. Just install Calce, on your computer, and Ansible will say everything like this. So if you're getting pissed off at Ansible, just do that for a little bit of relief. Now you can imagine that some of those things that we ask the test suite and test framework to do are things that not everyone should have to reinvent over and over and over again. So there's this package called standard test roles. It's Ansible roles, Ansible inventory, and various scripts. Now these are not in the spec. These are ways of implementing the spec easily. And we've made sure that those are separated. This is akin to a test framework, God help me. Every time you say framework, like a bit, little butterfly somewhere dies. But this is a way of making it easy for tests not to have to reproduce logic all over the place. So if you find stuff that in your implementation of tests that seems to be repetitive between different diskit repos, that's where it goes. Merlin has done a really good job of maintaining this. Merlin Matisius, and he's on hash Fedora CI, like all of us. You'll see that at the end on Freenode. So that's where the development happens. And this is getting pretty stable. People are using it to good use. And one of the criteria for getting it stable, I think we're getting to the point where we're almost there, is to have it itself be tested. And then we're ready to say, yep, now it's stable. All right, so what we're going to do, we can ask questions, we can dive into the actual spec, read through it, look at the different parts. We're not going to read every single word in it, but you get an idea of the kind of things that are involved. In addition, we have a tutorial that will work through here, given sufficient bandwidth, internet access, and so on, that actually takes you through some examples. Then there's this link here which has a body of tests being upstreamed, which Tim's actually going to talk about more. When is your talk?
Tomorrow morning at 9:30.
Yeah. So he's going to dive into this project, which is where a lot of the tests are coming from. The existing tests. Remember, we're curating them. Some of them are coming from upstream. Some of them are coming from downstream and are being upstream, so to speak. We can dive into, perhaps here or perhaps in Fred's talk, to adding inventory for different things like modules or new kinds of test subjects. We could look at how to invoke non-Ansible stuff via this standard interface. We can look at how to bring upstream tests in. We can look at examples of that, and so on. But I would like to dive quickly into the spec, unless you have another suggestion. We'll look through it and get you familiar with it. Any questions before we dive in there? Yeah?
So far, it seems like the more the merrier from your point of view. But in my experience, in many projects, tests tend to grow so much that it becomes a burden to run them. It really takes so long. So, are there any limits or recommendations? Maybe you have to split them, how to categorize them so people can have like some quick tests or anything like that where running a test is only in the next 2 days.
That's a good idea. I mean, a good point. So far, we've been so gung-ho on the fact that we have no tests. in the spec, there's a way to say the test context, the kind of expectations for the setup and so on. And we could use that to say more deep testing versus more the initial gating testing. And in fact, again, invoking my future self, talking about the pipeline that runs these things, there's a portion of the pipeline that gates, a portion of the pipeline that just says, prevents a broken change from affecting other developers. And then there's a portion of the pipeline that then tests further and batches updates and does maybe day-long tests and so on. And if those break, it will ask for things to be reverted, with the assumption that the first part caught everything that would affect progress in Fedora in general, prevent people's machines from booting on rawhide and so on, those kinds of things. And the second part would actually find deeper bugs or performance bugs or so on. So I think that's where the split comes. I think there's places for that, but we should actually have an opinion about how that's tagged and marked. All right, let's look at this. Is there anything else before we dive in? Okay, so the spec is here on the Fedora wiki. And you can see that it's written in quite some detail. Let's zoom out a bit because turns out this screen zooms in just fine. It's written in quite some detail about the definitions of what we can expect, what the terminology that we use. We talked about test subjects, we talked about test suites, test results is a Boolean pass or fail, test artifacts, which we'll keep referring to, are ways that test produces output. Testing system, as we said, is like the CI system that's coordinating this, and so on. So again, we talked about these responsibilities already. They're listed here much more verbosely. If you find stuff that's confusing or unclear, this is a spec. It needs to be specific. So I like that. That's a bug if it's not. I'm not expecting to read through all this right here, but just to get you familiar with it. The requirements, all written in the should not, must not type language. And here we see how the testing system should stage stuff, where it should look for things, what needs to be pre-installed, what a job or runner of this thing should have ready, then the invocation. Now, you can see that here there's different kinds of test subjects, and we pass the test subject to the playbook. And different kinds of test subjects have different identifiers. And we use a kind of a simple globbing to tell what is what. Further ones can be added here. So it's some areas where this is not clear yet is for modules, you know, whether they fit into the repo bucket or whether there's other descriptions of how to describe to the testing system and to the test that I want to test a module. You can see there's some basic stuff already there, Docker, kubectls, those are used, and RPMs, those are the ones that the tests typically use a lot of already. Then there's, in addition to the test subject, there's what we call the test context, which is how the environment that the test can then expect, and the environment to which the test is written. So a certain test might be testing, I'm writing to slash user, and I'm doing this and that, like that's part of the test. So it doesn't work in Atomic Host, where you have a slash user that just cannot work. Regardless of the kind of test subject, regardless of the dependencies installed, whatever, it's just not intended at all for Atomic Host. So we use Ansible tags, you'll see those when we walk through the tutorial, to tag the test to say, what is it intended to test? In some cases, intended to test everything, in some cases, only a few things. So as you get more familiar with these tests and we start to find new test contexts, we can add further ones. And this may be where CMO's point comes in, where we might have some tests with special tags that say, you know, this is a performance test or this is a longer running test and so on. And sort of gives some expectation of what the test is trying to do.
Maybe a small note here, there is some initiative about test metadata for upstream, so it's another project probably, so
mm-hmm.
so and it should also solve these differences between test context and subject.
Right. So hopefully we can represent that with these two concepts. So then here's the kind of stuff that the testing system does to execute the tests. And what's interesting is that you can run any of these tests on your own machine, just like you can build a spec file on your own machine. It's fundamental that you can run any of these tests and invoke them on your own machine. Even if they call out to do things elsewhere, they should call out from your machine. And this is, so some of these things when we walk through the tutorial, you'll see us taking some shortcuts, obviously, because we are not as rigorous and strict. You know, that we don't have to follow the spec exactly when we invoke the tests. But this is the basic stuff that you'll see us doing, such as setting different variables, both Ansible variables and environment variables for where the test subjects are, where to put out artifacts, those tags that we just talked about, these ones up here, which ones we choose to invoke the test with, where Ansible should find its inventory. One interesting thing is that the test itself can specify its own inventory, and its inventory is a great way of starting up the test subject into a VM. You'll see this in practice. in a second. But if there is, if a test doesn't care, then there are standard ones that fall in. The spec describes how to do that. Tests are always invoked as root, and then the test itself, if it wants to test something as non-root, which it should also, it should test both. It should add a user and pseudo that user and run further tests as that user. The test, the playbook itself, the Ansible playbook, the exit code, success and failure. Okay, yeah, Mike?
Does number 5 mean that tests are not executable in OpenShift?
That's an interesting topic to dive into. In general, a lot of the stuff here needs a pretty privileged OpenShift container. We are testing an operating system here. That means we are going to run all over privileges, a new kernels in many cases, a Docker service. We're going to test all sorts of aspects of a system. It is possible. We have done testing this inside of OpenShift, but you need sufficient privileges in order to do that. And I've done some interesting work on getting dev KVM inside a container so that you don't need a privileged container, but you do need root access in the container. Otherwise, yeah, a lot of this doesn't work.
Well, yeah, I would just clarify, like, root becomes separated when you're talking about containers, right?
That's
like,
correct.
Like, so much stuff will work without capsysadmin, right? Basically,
yes.
Default Docker privileges
default
is very different from true privilege. Like, there's a big difference between default Docker and Docker run dash dash privilege, I guess is what I'm saying. Right?
That's right. So the root inside a container is not the same as root on the system. The one caveat is that you can see that in many cases we want to invoke a VM. So we need devkvm. You don't need root to access devkvm in a typical Fedora and RHEL system, but you do need it in a container. It's not there by default. So that's the one wrinkle where typically if you're doing this today inside of OpenShift and invoking these tests in OpenShift, you run a privileged container only for the reason of getting devkvm. Other than that,
is devkvm the other thing you need?
It is, and I've done some work on a OCI hook that actually just gets KVM inside the container, and that's interesting. Hopefully, we can finish that up.
We could probably bring it into less fun, perhaps.
Yeah, that'd be cool. I have a card for OpenShift that's up there, and I'll CC you on it. Just had some discussion and stuff. All right, put the results in the right place, and. There is some discussion with the folks who want to use this in logging, data aggregation, and actually use some sort of big data concepts on the results and artifacts to name the results in certain ways. So if they came from restraint, or if they came from, if they have an XUnit output, or if they have a tap output, they can be named a certain way, but that's not in the spec yet. All right, so then it goes into more details, and so on. So we're gonna jump over to the tutorial and walk you through a few examples of this so you can see how approachable it is and so you get familiar with it. But are there any questions on the spec before we do that? Well, let's go on then. So here we have, I would encourage you to open this URL if you would like. Follow along on your own machines. This is all literally doable on your own machines right now. Given internet access, there's nothing bad here, big here. All the commands that you need to get started are here in this tutorial. So that's fedoraproject.org/wiki/ci/tests. All right, so what we're gonna do is, and a lot of this is packaged in Fedora 25 and 26. I am one guilty soul who still has Fedora 24 on this machine. So I have done some, I've installed this manually from RPMs, but it's all in the standard repos now. You can just actually, you know, do sudo dnf install to get this stuff in place.
That's color scheme, that is really hard to read from that here.
Let's do that.
Thank you.
Bigger font?
Either.
Nice. So, as you can see on my Fedora 24 system, that last little package isn't there, but on your systems it should be, because you all upgraded, right?
Wait, but why are you doing the dev inside a host system instead of a container?
That's like one of those guilty questions, like, do you
floss?
Yeah, exactly. And I agree, you should do that. I'm not set up for that. So, we can clone the gzip package, just as we want. So, again, just to clarify on this, here you can see this is work in progress. The upstreaming of tests is currently ongoing. Like we said, Jonathan put the first test in diskit. That means using fed package to clone the gzip one won't find me the tests right now. I want to make that change in the next few days. But we need to clone them from this other repo where they're staged and ready for inclusion. So, let's do that. And now we can see in this other repo from the upstream first, which Tim is going to talk about at 10 tomorrow. 10:30 tomorrow. 9:30 tomorrow. Boom. The entire repo is the contents of the test directory. So imagine in your mind, do the mental mapping that we are now in a diskit repo. We are in the test directory. If you look at let's look at the RPM OS tree. Let's just look at it quickly. Oh, Fedora. You'll see that here is a test directory inside of the diskit repo. When we go into tests, we see this content. We see test.yaml, actually. This is a litter file here, as is this. We see something a lot more like this. But in the gzip repo, we will be in the test repo already. You see the test.yaml, that's the entry point playbook that we use, that the invocation specification prescribes. And let's take a look further. So we become root. Now we can run the tests. So the basic way to run the tests is just to run them like that. What it does, I jumped ahead there. I was set up, I guess I was trying this out more. So let's do that again. I had environment variables in place that told us to do something different than what. You'll see those environment variables in a second. So here we go. As you see, we have calce, very nice. And we're green, we're good. So this actually worked. Let's see what's in this test. Let's see what it looks like. Let's take a look. So if we look at test.yaml, we can see it's just including this other file, testsimple.yaml. Let's look at that one. We can see that there is a bunch of code here to invoke a shell script. And the shell script could be an entire test suite. And this is the kind of code that then moves to the standard test roles. This is not there yet, but that's where we would put a lot of these tasks. We can see that there are variables that go into the spec file, into the playbook that tell it about the artifacts directory. There are tags like we talked about before. This test is valid across Atomic, class of Fedora, containers. We have some extra stuff here to invoke the script. Why? Because we cannot assume that the script is always local. We know in the Atomic case, in the container case, we need to copy the test into the machine to actually execute it. And we have executing the tests here. We have pulling out the logs. So this is an example of a completely standalone spec compatible that doesn't use the standard test role helpers to make its job any easier. We'll bring those in a second. So here, let's try putting these the artifacts in a different directory. Let's just show you how that works. This is how you pass a variable to Ansible, and we'll tell it, I really want the test artifacts in temp output. Hopefully less temp output. We can see there's some test artifacts. In this case, it's a very simple test, and we can see that there's a log for diagnosing any problems. Typically, this gets to be very complex and big, but we're starting with a very simple example. And again, we can specify tags like this to say that we'd like to only run the test if it's compatible with a classic context. You can do this for atomic, you can do this for containers, you can do this for a classic system so far.
So
and again,
could you comma separate it if there's more than one?
You can, yeah. Like that. Or dash this. Like this? Cool. So let's start bringing the inventory into it and the test subject into it. So far, I ran those tests assuming that gzip was already installed on the system. It's really testing the system in situ, testing the system as it exists, but that's not the intent here. A lot of tests can do that. That's great, but imagine you had a test that needed to reboot, or you had a test that needed to destroy the LVM disks or something. The whole idea then would be to start something, smash it up, verify what happened, and say yes or no, that was right or wrong, rather than do it right then on the system that the test is being invoked on. But let's start with something simple. We're going to bring in, a so this here tells us.
Can I make a request? Can you drag the bottom of the terminal up? Or
oh,
just stick control L's every time?
You know what I can also do?
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. Control L also.
How about that also? Okay, so here we are. This makes me a little bit blush. I wish this was simpler. The intent here is that the testing system will check if this inventory file exists in the test, and if so, it will use it. This is an Ansible inventory. It tells us how to launch something to then run Ansible against. So it starts up a system that Ansible can then test. And if it doesn't exist, we're going to use the default. Now, if you could figure out a quicker way to bring a shorter shell snippet to put in a tutorial, I would love that. So far, that's as good as we got. Okay, now let's get a RPM. Did it really go that fast? It didn't.
Well, they're coming at the beginning.
Right. Burn. Okay, so now we have an RPM to test. Now the first kind of inventory is a really simple kind of it makes you question the intent here, like, are you really sure you know what you're talking about? It's going to use that RPM as the test subject. And the inventory scripts that are available with standard test roles, given that there's no inventory directory here, we'll use the ones in user share Ansible entry.
Doesn't that have to say the full MVR of the, like, that's not a real file name, right? Gzip.rpm?
I did download it to that file name, so
oh,
it actually does exist.
Okay.
Let's just make the tutorial shorter, but hey, if that's confusing, maybe we can put it back. So these standard inventory scripts know how to start a Docker container, install RPMs in their dependencies, how to start a Kube image. There can be more of these. There should be more of these. Maybe we will invent one tomorrow in Fred's workshop. And we contribute it back to the standard test roles RPM so that. So that's a good question. Inventory files in Ansible can take on all sorts of forms. One, and it depends on the content. So if this Ansible inventory and the inventory or the standard directory, if it's a file, it will read it. If it's a directory, it will enumerate it. If it's an executable, it will execute it. In this case, they are executables. In this case, it's actually a directory of executables.
That's dynamic inventory generator.
That's right. It will execute them all. We can look at them. Let's just do it like this. These are inventory files. They have lots of stuff in them ready for ready to launch a kcal image, set it up with a certain port to access to have SSH work properly here. Then they launch it with a cloudnet so that you can access it with the right keys. And there's a lot of work that has gone into this over time. Different people, some people here have also contributed to it. And there's also a debug thing, which we'll turn on in a second. But let's start. Right, so there's a standard way that a dynamic inventory executable puts out some JSON. Well, let's execute this. Yeah, let's execute this just as a dumb script and not by Ansible. So user share Ansible inventory standard. Let's see. So what's it going and doing? It's going and installing that RPM, and then it outputs on standard out a bunch of stuff that Ansible can consume to say, here's the host. And in this case, we tell it, really just connect to the local machine. The local machine is ready for you. Let's come back at this. Let's look at this for kcals and Docker images. It'll make more sense. And now, when Ansible, here, let me execute it like this. And given that Ansible inventory file and the test subject environment variable, when we execute this like this, it does those tasks and then invokes the playbook on that system which the RPM was installed. In this case, it's just the local system. This is really the dumb case. Let's move on to atomic hosts. This gets more interesting then. We already have the Ansible inventory gobbledygook pasted in here. So let's get a kcal. If this takes too long, I have one that I've prepared before, as you do, and this is taking too long. That's minutes. So let's copy atomic kcal. Oh, I already have that. Nice. Right, because I have a half done. So here we are. And we can tell the playbook that the test subject is this atomic image that we totally downloaded, but I've downloaded before. And that's a stock image that came from Fedora, nothing fancy inside it. This is just normal stuff. And again, we can then, well, let's execute that playbook and see what it does. In this case, it launches a virtual machine, takes a minute, takes a moment, and waits for SSH to come up, and then it will output JSON that Ansible can use to connect to that machine. It's taking longer than I thought.
An interesting choice is that inventory files responsible for provisioning,
yeah,
instead of the playbook being responsible for provisioning.
We went through that before, and we actually had the playbook responsible for provisioning. Turns out it's really awkward to have one playbook execute another playbook inside of there. And Ansible already had this concept baked in, so then we started just using it. That was one of the changes that came after the initial version of the spec.
But shouldn't the default, because I'm guessing the Ansible test files will be installed by default on the testing machine, right?
Yeah, so in the staging part of the spec, it says, this is the one place where what I said before was not completely honest. And it is that when you stage for executing tests, you have to install these packages. Typically, when you run Ansible on a Fedora or RHEL system, you must install these packages. This adds one more to the list. Therefore, these standard roles are available.
But the default should be for the testing playbook to do the provisioning, right? Like, instead of overriding the behavior and putting in like your own inventory file. You should have like the opposite semantic of I want this to be taken care of by the roles.
Right. So we'll look at what test where we do exactly that. And a test can take over its own provisioning completely, albeit, and it can do it. I think you did this in one of your work on RPM OS tree. The test can still do what Ralph is saying. No problem. It can do provisioning. But we moved a lot of the defaults so that we use inventory. Because it's much easier, much more sane for people to comprehend. They can still do what you're talking about, Ralph, and still do what you did, John, in RPM OS tree, with a module or however you want to do your provisioning of the test subject. Those are legit choices. In fact, so when we haven't yet, but when we bring the cockpit tests, cockpit has hundreds of CI tests that go all over the system. We have our own provisioning of a VM, launching it, and interacting with it, and all this weird stuff. Yeah, we'll just tie that off with this spec, with those, either with those inventory or in the playbook, and then we'll go like that. So let's run this while we're talking, because that's useful use of time. So as you can see, that standard inventory file outputted a whole bunch of stuff, how to connect to the thing. You connect on this port, on this IP, with this password, with this SSH key, and that allows this playbook then, whoops, wrong command, to do exactly that. In fact, let me cancel this. I'm going to show you one more thing. If you put test debug plus one in front of this, you get a lot more output later for actually debugging this thing if it breaks.
So Steph, in terms of those inventory scripts, do they always report JSON to come out, or can you do static inventory?
In theory, a static inventory, in theory you can make those scripts not, in your test, be a non-executable file in slash test slash inventory. No, I don't think that works. I have not found a way to make that work. If you do, then and it's standard Ansible, then that would be cool.
Yeah, no, it would work. I will talk about that later.
Yeah. And let's do it either now, if we have time, or in the workshop, we can explore different things like that. So as you can see, we ran it against this gzip test now, ran against the atomic host that was launched, and we checked that gzip worked in an existing atomic host. And then because I had that test debug equals one thing, the VM is actually still running. If I like, and if everything went down and just broke, I can actually then still SSH into this foobar and so on. I can see that this is a host.
Is there a way to flash by a VNC or something like that as well?
We could do that. Yes,
in case you're testing SSH in that case.
Yeah, that's true. So typically when you're doing something like SSH, just to keep in mind, you will, it will be a more complicated example, but you would launch something. Inside there, you would probably start SSH on a different port, or you would launch it in such a way that by default SSH was on a port, and Ansible could connect through there, and then another SSH process inside, or you figure out some way. Those are the awkward situations. That, networking. When you're doing CI, we managed to test these awkward situations really well, but each of those requires a little bit of like stretching and scratching and figuring stuff out. Okay, mm-hmm. Let's disconnect from here.
So
step thoughts about what's responsible for the VM, so like the inventory file launch the VM, you ran it again, would it create a second one? Or is it really the first one?
Either you're gonna like this answer or you're just gonna go like this with both hands. What happens, what we do in the inventory file. So typically inventory files in Ansible are meant for existing infrastructure, for me to find my cloud, for me to find my Amazon VMs and so on. Dynamic inventories use like that. What we do is we watch the parent process that invoked us. I'll prove this to you. We watch the parent process that invoked us, and when it goes away, we die. So if you see, if you look, we can see that it still is running. That's the inventory script. And if you look for the qcow, it could be that more than one are running, because maybe I did this before. I'm sorry, not qcow, q and u. And now there's two of them, right? And if I actually exit my, because I invoke from my shell and not from Ansible, when I do that, one of these should go away. The second one, because I did test debug, won't go away because it turned off that cleanup logic,
cool.
Right? But if I go like this, and then you can see that one of the qmu processes went away from that previous invocation that I did. I launched it right from my shell, output the JSON, you remember that? And that one didn't get cleaned up because it was watching my bash process. And now when I exited bash, it got cleaned up. Implementation details are sometimes scary. But I think we have a solid concept underneath which all sorts of stuff can be tried here. That's the point, right? So again, we already looked at test debug. Let's just look at one more example here. Of a container. This may take a little longer. Let's go into gzip. So I exported a test subject saying this is a Docker container to be pulled from the Docker registry at that place. Now, other containers, other OCI containers and so on are accounted for differently. I don't think the inventory script for them is written yet, needs to be written, so that an OCI tar type file can be imported and tested. That would be great. But so far, a lot of the stuff that's happening in Fedora is around Docker containers. And let's invoke that. And that didn't work. Why? Because I exited and didn't have my inventory environment variable, so I actually tested on the local system. Great, this is not looking good. There we go. So now you can see it's actually starting a Docker container. The container folks have done a really, really nice, great, amazing job of making the container so small that we have to install stuff in it in order to run Ansible against it, which is good. But here at the Flock conference, and because of the problem that you brought up in that State of the Union, we had to download about 200 megabytes of bullshit metadata in order to get any packages installed, which is, again, bigger than the container itself. Anyway, lots of little things to work through and solve, but this is not something that purely affects tests. This affects a lot of these concepts in general. So, give this a second. That's why it's slow. It's blocked on Yum right now, and you'll see the Yum output come up soon. It's just the metadata downloading takes this long.
You say that the first run of the Ansible payload didn't work, but it still existed fine.
That's correct. So I showed how we were not. Let's just make it clear. As we're doing these commands, we're doing a subset of all the things the spec says you must do. So we are not musting. We are not following the spec exactly. The spec says you must set test subject's environment variable, and you must set it as an Ansible variable as well. You must do various things that we're not doing. We forgot to set the test subject environment, or that environment variable. In addition, we forgot to tell Ansible about the inventory, which you can either do by an environment variable, or you can do on the command line with a dash I, either one works. And how a testing system does that is up to it. We chose to use that big long line to set an environment variable. So we did not follow the spec, therefore it did not act the way we would expect it to.
But the checks is part of the standard flow.
In order to launch a QCOW and in order to launch a Docker container, it does use the default behavior from standard test roles. It doesn't have its own inventory.
But then the check about the artifact is not mentioned, is not incorporated with the payload or anything.
I think it worked to just execute against the wrong system. Does that make sense?
I'm just worried that basically that means that you run the test and everything went fine, except if you didn't test what you were supposed to be testing.
Yeah.
So if something goes south, the CI system is saying, well, everything went fine.
You said a good point. Yesterday, someone had, Jack had a good idea that we should pass through the CI system an invalid set of conditions that we know will fail through the entire thing, not just through this part, but through the pipelines and so on. And that helps two things. It shows up in the reports and data as the system works. It also helps us be alerted. We should kind of do a false positive check. I think that's a good idea. So I hope that will cover that case sufficiently well. That is testing the spec and testing that the CI system is following the spec. We can look at each of these musts. We can probably do a wrong thing for each of them, and we can make that work that way. I was going to talk with Ari about that and see if that's something we can work on, when we can work it in.
Stuff is 9:59. You have 1 minute.
I have 1 minute. 1 minute. Okay. Where are we? So the tutorial goes through adding tests, goes through how to work with upstream first, although Tim is going to describe this in more detail, so I'm glad we can move over that. Writing a new test, where to put stuff, how to execute a shell command. Hopefully we can get that simpler. How to tag a test to be run in different situations. Mm-hmm. Test contexts, wrapping a script. Again, we use some of the same examples. I would like to have this tutorial go into wrapping an install test. This is the glib2 test. That's a kind of a GNOME or glib concept for installing unit tests and then running them locally, sort of integration tests. It really tests the libraries that it's using and so on. Wrapping a beaker test. Those are tests that Red Hat QE wrote, and this is how to actually make them work. There's restraint test, which is another test framework. And I'd like to add module tests to this tutorial and add a few more things. So, we're all done. Anyone who wants to get more information, go to Tim's talk, go to Fred's talk, and come to my talk on